Hello, my name is Norman Lahr. In this video I will present our work, Sidechannel Information Set Decoding Using Iterative Chunking. We evaluated our new approach to the classic Macaulay's hardware reference implementation. The other members of our team are Ruben Niederhagen from the University of Southern Denmark in Odense, Richard Petri from the Fraunhofer Institute for Secure Information Technology in Darmstadt, Germany, and Simona Samardjiska from the Radboud Universiteit in Nijmegen in the Netherlands. To understand our motivation, I start with some background information and challenges about the targeted crypto system, which is the classic Macaulay's or Niederreiter scheme respectively, followed by the approach of information set decoding and reaction-based attacks. Then I will explain a basic reaction-based attack on the decryption process of the Niederreiter scheme and what is the impact if it is combined with information set decoding approaches. Afterwards, I will introduce iterative chunking, how it is applied, and what is the impact when we use information set decoding as well. Finally, I will briefly explain how we evaluate the attack in practice and present the overall evaluation results. Classic Macaulay's is one of the finalists for key encapsulation mechanisms in the third round of the NIST PQC competition, and it is based on the Niederreiter crypto system with binary copper codes. Classic Macaulay's is considered to be a conservative choice. The parameters are the code length n, the code dimension k, the guaranteed error correction capability or decoder capacity t, and the field size m. The authors of the submission defines these five parameter sets according to the different security levels. They are identified by the prefix chem Macaulay's, followed by the code length and the error correction capability. The operations of the Niederreiter crypto system basically work as follows. The key generation starts with randomly choosing an irreducible copper polynomial g of x of degree t over the extension field 2 to the m, and choosing a random list of n distinct elements in gf2 to the m, which are the support of the polynomial g. Both g and the list of alphas represents the private key. From these values, the corresponding parity check matrix is computed and returned as the public key. The encryption operation is rather simple. First, we generate a random binary vector E of Hamming weight T and length N. The ciphertext, or syndrom S, is then computed by the matrix vector product of H and E. The decryption begins with the decoding of the syndrome to get the error locator polynomial sigma. Then we identify the roots by evaluating sigma at the private support list alpha 0 to alpha n minus 1. If we identify a root at alpha a, the corresponding position in E is set to 1 or to 0 otherwise. The decryption process depends on the error correcting decoder. The currently established approach is the Baerle-Kamp-Massey decoder, and there is also the Patterson decoder. The security of the Niederreiter scheme relies on the decoding problem, which is defined as follows. Compute the error vector E, given the binary parity check matrix H, and the ciphertext S, which equals to H multiplied by E, where E is a uniform random weight T vector of length n. The fastest attacks known to break the decoder problem use information set decoding on short ISD. Current approaches like Prange, Stern, Mai, Moira, Tomei in short MMT, and Becker, Zhu, Mai, Moira in short BJMM solve the problem of the classic Macaulay's parameter submitted to NIST with an infeasible cost, of which is, of course, as desired from a security point of view. For example, the approach MMT requires 277.6 bit operations for the highest parameter set. Another security aspect is implementation attacks. Reaction-based attacks are known and feasible attacks to code-based crypto systems. The assumption for these attacks is that an attacker has access to a decryption oracle which returns success or failure for a given input. The basic idea is that reactions caused by a prepared input lead to a secret key or plaintext recovery. Sidechannel information, like timing or power consumption, can be used as unintentional feedback from a decryption oracle. An example of a provoked reaction is to feed a decoder with manipulated input, such that its decoding capacity exceeds and it leaks exploitable information. Currently, plain text recovery approaches like the approach of Shufuan et al. From 2009 reveal bits individually and require a high amount of queries, which is the code length, for example, 8192. So, the first contribution of our work is the introduction of iterative chunking for plain text recovery on classic macOS. In short, iterative chunking is an attack strategy which uses cumulative queries to recover multiple positions of secret information at once. Additionally, we optimized the parameters and the strategy. Therewith, we are able to significantly decrease the effort of a reaction-based attack, for example, by approximately 90% for the highest parameter set of the classic macOS NIST parameters. The second contribution is the combination of iterative chunking and information set decoding to further decrease the amount of queries for successful plaintext recovery. In our work, we estimate the trade-off between required queries and computational power so that we know how many queries can be saved if an attacker has high computational resources. We evaluated our attack approach with a simulation using an ideal decryption oracle, and we also developed a practical decryption oracle to mount a sidechannel attack by exploiting the electromagnetic radiation leakage of the current reference FPGA design of classic macOS. Let's have a closer look at reaction attacks and how we can mount them on the Niederreiter cryptosystem. Reaction attack has the following assumptions. First, we need access to a decryption oracle, which is an implementation practice. For our work, we chose the Niederreiter FPGA implementation of Wang et al., which they present at the Peak Crypto in 2018. Further, we assume that an attacker is able to ask a decryption oracle for infinite times. We target a plaintext recovery attack, so we assume that an attacker has no access to the output, but he gets direct or indirect leakage, for instance from protocol message or physical side channels. We were inspired by the work of Shufuan et al. From 2009, in which they describe a timing attack on the Patterson decoder of macOS FPGA implementation. Nevertheless, the FPGA design of our target instantiates the Bellecamp-Massey decoder with a constant time implementation. This means it is not possible to apply the approach of Shufuan et al. However, the FPGA design shows a power leakage when exhausting the decoder's capacity T. If the syndrome contains more than T errors, the computation of an error locator polynomial fails and the result is a random polynomial. The corresponding error vector shows a very low Hamming weight after the evaluation with the support. To examine whether we can exploit this effect for our target, we performed a power simulation using the Hamming distance for the register transfers. In the plot, you see the simulated power trace. It is quite simple to identify the five different stages of the decryption process which are specific for the Bellecamp-Massey decoder. It starts with an additive FFT, which is used to compute the double syndrome in the next section. Then, the Bellecamp-Massey decoder is applied, which puts out the error locator polynomial. In the fourth section, the polynomial is evaluated using another additive FFT call. In the last section, the error vector is reconstructed, which is the most interesting part for our desired leakage. At this step, it is obvious that we can identify a significant gap between a correctly decoded error, which has a high weight, and a faulty one, which shows just a small weight. Therewith, we have the preconditions for a power attack. Now, we know that there is exploitable leakage when we induce an additional error to the syndrome. But how can we do this? By just having the binary parity check matrix H and the syndrome or ciphertext S. Let's have a look at the encryption operation of the Niederreiter cryptosystem. Here you see an exemplary matrix H and an error vector E, which equals to S when both are multiplied. When computing the matrix vector product, one can simply search for the ones in the vector E and horizontally add the column vector at the corresponding positions. So the ones in E represent the errors, and we now know that there are exactly t errors included. If we now want to induce an additional error, we must search for a position in E which equals to 0 and add the corresponding column vector of H to the original syndrome vector to get the manipulated syndrome S prime. Therewith, we have constructed a syndrome which includes an additional error. How can you use this mechanism in a reaction-based attack to recover an entire error vector? The idea is to iteratively test each error vector position, whether it is a 0 or 1. To do this, we add a corresponding column vector of H to the syndrome and request the decryption oracle whether the decryption succeeds. If the oracle returns true, the decryption was successful and the decoder was able to decode the syndrome. This means that we cancelled out an existing error in the syndrome before and we decreased the total number of errors in the syndrome. So it must be a 1 at the position in the original error vector. In the other case, we increased the number of errors before, which now exceeds the capacity of the decoder and the oracle returns a failure. Therefore, we recover this position as 0. The total procedure requires n iterations, since we need to ask for each position of E. How can we reduce the number of queries to decrease the effort of the attack? So, we can consider information set decoding. But, since it is infeasible for the entire number of bits in E, we can first recover a specific subset of positions with reaction-based attacks. And then we spend computational power and perform information set decoding to solve the reduced decoding problem for the remaining positions. To identify how many queries we can save with an available computational resource, we need an estimated trade-off. There is a default upper limit for the recovery of positions with a reaction-based attack, which is k. Therewith, we are able to construct a uniquely solvable linear equation, which can be solved by using Gaussian elimination with a negligible effort. We evaluated the procedure with a mathematically derived estimation for the trade-off between required number of queries and the computational complexity. The plot shows the resulting curves for all NIST parameter sets and the ISD approaches Stern and MMT. Unfortunately, there is no compact representation of the concrete complexity of BJMM, so we left it out for our analysis. As one can see, we can save several hundred queries if we assume, for example, a feasible cost of 40-bit operations. Now, what is iterative chunking? We start by answering the question, what happens if we ask for two error positions at once? If we do this, we add two distinct columns of H and call this cumulative query a chunk. Then, there are four different cases of an oracle response, which are listed on the table on the right-hand side. The first column of the table shows the initial state of the query chunk for the positions I and J. The second shows the state of the pair after flipping the values. The third column shows the total number of errors in the new state, and the last column shows the oracle's answer. So, if we have a look at the first row, we assume here that the original error vector has zeros at the positions I and J. If we add the corresponding positions of the matrix H, the resulting syndrome will include two additional errors. And so, it is not possible to decode it, and the oracle returns false. We name this case a load chunk, whereas we call the other cases high chunks. In the cases in the second and the third row, the arrow positions are just switched, since one arrow is added and the other is cancelled out. In total, the arrow weight does not change and the decoding succeeds. In the last case, both arrows are cancelled out, and so the decoding succeeds as well. As one can notice, the density of 1s in E is less than 2.1%. In the most cases, E consists of zeros. And, as we just saw, we can detect exactly this case. Now we introduce the term chunk size beta, which is 2 here. What happens if we iteratively increase the input chunk size beta? In the table, you see the 8 cases when we increase the chunk size by 1. So now the vector or the chunk has a size 3. Now there are 4 cases in which the decoding capacity is exceeded and 4 cases for which the oracle return true. So we are not able to distinguish one specific case to recover the original bit pattern. But if we already have a recovered position where we get a 1, we are able to decrease the total number of errors in the syndrome by adding the corresponding vector to the syndrome to cancel out the error. Then we get the unique case again, and we can identify the all zero case. Now we can iteratively continue this procedure to increase the chunk size to ask for even more positions at once. Therewith, we developed the following attack strategy. Iteratively increment the chunk size beta if an additional 1 position is identified. Reduce the number of errors in the syndrome with the known 1 position. Since we have to identify the exact position of a 1 in a high chunk, we apply so-called subchunking, which means that we apply the identification with a divide and conquer approach. If beta gets larger, the possibility of a high chunk increases. This leads to more subchunking, of course. So there must be an optimal beta t, which minimizes the number of queries, what we will see on the next slide. If beta equals beta t, we collect the high chunks in a so-called bucket, for example of size n minus k. Then we solve the bucket at the end using information set decoding. Now, what is the optimal chunk size to minimize the number of queries? Here in both plots, you see the number of queries for the chunk sizes from 2 to 24. On the left-hand side, you see the curves for the theoretical estimation for all proposed NIST parameters. And on the right-hand side, you see the curves of the iterative chunking approach implemented using the script language Python. As one can see, both plots show an equal behavior, and you can also see that the number of required queries quickly decreases when we increase the chunk size. Here, we can also identify the different minima for the number of queries, which are at the chunk size 17 for the 3 highest parameter sets, and 18 and 19 for the lowest ones. Now, we know the optimal chunk size. And again, we can apply information set decoding to further decrease the number of queries. The graph shows our estimated trade-off between computational cost and required number of queries for Stern and MMT. As you can see, we can save additional queries. For example, we can save circa 80 queries if we spend 40 bit operations of computational power. Beside the theoretical and simulated evaluation, we also mounted a practical experiment. The setup is depicted in the picture on the right. We integrated the design of Wang et al. To a Sakura X board, which you see on the left side of the setup. The board provides a Xilinx Kintex 7 FPGA, which we run at a frequency of 24 MHz. We acquired the traces with an EM probe from Lahr and measured the signal with a picoscope running at 500 megasamples. Further, we developed various scripts for the acquisition, the side-channel decryption oracle, and the iterative chunking strategy, which is the same script as for the simulation before. We built the practical side-channel decryption oracle by using Will's t-test to identify a gap in the error vector construction at the end of the decryption process. To do so, we need two reference traces. One from a high chunk, which indicates a successful decryption, and another one for a low chunk, indicating a failed decryption. Now, we compare a trace of a query and decide if it is similar to a trace of a high or of a low chunk. To get a better alignment of the trace and get a little speed up for the computation, we compress a trace within a clock cycle to just one value. Further, we update the reference high trace since its behavior changes due to the removal of errors in the prepared syndrome. Here are the results of our evaluation. We evaluated the iterative chunking approach for all parameters proposed at the NIST competition. We determined the average required number of queries for a successful recovery of an entire error vector. Here we have the numbers for the optimal chunk sizes. For comparison, we also give the number of traces when no chunking is used, so the chunk size is 1 for all queries. The data for the simulation and the experiments was gathered from the same sets of 10 different key pairs and 10 different plaintext ciphertext pair per key pair, so we have 100 in total for each parameter set. Since the practical oracle do not fail, we have the same numbers for the simulation and the practical experiment. In the last two columns, we also give the theoretical prediction and the number of required queries for applying information set decoding at a cost of around 2 to the 40 operations. As one can see, we are able to drastically reduce the number of queries with iterative chunking. For example, we save circa 90% of the queries when mount an attack for the highest parameter set and reduce the number of from 6,530 to 654, which also follows the theoretical prediction. And we can reduce the numbers further to 577 queries when we use information set decoding. To conclude our work, we finally could show that iterative chunking reduces the number of queries by an order of magnitude, as we just saw, from 6,530 to 654 queries, which is a reduction by circa 90% for the highest parameter set. We saw that the additional use of information set decoding decreases the amount further. For example, by spending 40 bit operations, we could reduce the queries from 654 to 577, which is about 11.7%. We showed the application of iterative chunking for a specific information leakage, but we can, of course, use any feedback for a succeeded or failed decryption. So we consider a broader application to other code-based schemes. With that, thank you for your attention and your time.